بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. نبدأ إن شاء الله. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا، وانفعنا بما علمتنا، وزدنا علما وعملا وإخلاصا يا رب العالمين. أهلا وسهلا ومرحبا بكم إخواني وأخواتي الكرام والمتابعين والمتابعات في لقاء طيب مبارك إن شاء الله تعالى مع الأستاذ عبد الرحمن نشنوش والدكتور عبد الباري مشعل. أهلا وسهلا بكم فضيلة الدكتور عبد الباري والأستاذ عبد الرحمن.
أهلا وسهلا بك أخي العزيز، بارك الله فيك.
أهلا بكم،
حياكم الله. نحن الآن في اللقاء يتسع المجال إلى صوت واحد في الغرفة لما واحد يتكلم، فإن شاء الله نعطي المجال للمتحدث ثم التعليق ثم الكلام إن شاء الله من أي واحد بإذن الله تعالى. حياكم الله. الأستاذ الفاضل عبد الرحمن نشنوش، أهلا وسهلا بك وحياكم الله. برادر عبد الرحمن نشنوش ما شاء الله فاينانس مانجمنت اكسيكوتيف فايس بريزيدنت دايركتور اوف ديفلوبمنت يو اي اف كوربوريشن، مدير مالي التنفيذي ونائب الرئيس ومدير التطوير في شركه يو اي اف. اهلا وسهلا بكم يا استاذ عبد الرحمن.
الله يبارك فيك. السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته. جزاكم الله خير على الاستضافه الطيبه، وان شاء الله نسال الله سبحانه وتعالى ان ينفع بنا وان نجيب يعني على بعض الاستفسارات والاسئله المشاعه بين الناس ان شاء الله. وشكرا لكم.
اهلا وسهلا بكم. فضيله الدكتور عبد الباري مشعل، ما شاء الله انترناشونال ممبر اوف اسلاميك سوبرفايزوري بورد، عضو مجمع الفقه لامريكا الشماليه، عضو مجلس الحوكمه والاخلاقيات بهيئه المحاسبه والمراجعه للمؤسسات الماليه الاسلاميه، وخبير بمجمع الفقه الاسلامي الدولي. اهلا وسهلا بكم دكتور عبد الباري.
اهلا بكم دكتور رحابي، و يسعدني أن أكون معك إن شاء الله للإجابة على أهم التساؤلات حول التمويل الإسلامي في أمريكا
إن شاء الله. So إن شاء الله we'll our meeting إن شاء الله for 40 minutes إن شاء الله we'll cover إن شاء الله this topic إن شاء الله we'll cover يعني many questions that common questions common things people asking about financing. And we need, inshallah, to hear from Brother Abdul Rahman and from Dr. Abdul Mari some answers that will make us, inshallah, more comfortable when we have our own home, inshallah, to feel that everything okay with in halal way, inshallah, ta'ala. So the topic, inshallah, ta'ala, هل التمويل الإسلامي والتمويل الربوي سواء أم في خلاف؟ What's the difference between Islamic financing and conventional banking, regular banking? What's the difference if we can start with Brother Abdulrahman?
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. أما بعد. Once again, thank you very much for hosting this webinar and for hosting me. And I would be, inshallah, very delighted to answer any of the questions. So to start with the question, what is the difference between Islamic finance and conventional banking? This is probably one of the most common questions. And to start answering that in a very simple way, the structure of any Islamic finance tool, whether it is to finance a house or to finance some other commodity, is the fact that it's not structured as a loan. In the conventional banking, regular banking, when you go to finance anything, you actually finance it through having a loan. قرض. Loan in Islam is not supposed to be a tool to make money. Loan in Islam is actually a charitable act. So when somebody asks you to borrow money, you lend them the money in a charitable spirit, not in a spirit to make money, which is basically the essence of riba. So to summarize it and to make it very simple for people to understand is that Islamic finance means are ways to finance commodities rather than trying to buy and sell money. Why? Because money itself does not have any intrinsic value. So conventional banks are in the business of buying and selling money. For example, you know, would you, if I pull out a $20 bill and I ask you to buy it for $100, would anybody take the offer? Most likely not. or if you pull out a $20 bill and I'll ask you to buy it for $5, would you take my offer? Most likely not. This is in essence the spirit of the transactional process in a conventional banking. On the Islamic bank finance, on the Islamic finance side, the way that all three major finance means are structured differently. And therefore, the contracts are different, the process is different, and the essence of the actual contract is different.
طيب يا سيدي بارك الله فيك. Thank you, brother عبد الرحمن, for this information. Dr. Abdulbari, if I can ask you this question, هل التمويل الإسلامي أغلى من البنوك العادية? Is Islamic financing more expensive than the regular banks, or it is same?
في البداية أريد أن أعلق باختصار على ما تفضل به الأستاذ عبد الرحمن, وهو أن الأمر يعود إلى إشكالية قديمة جديدة, وهي الفرق بين البيع والربا. في القرآن الكريم الذين قالوا إنما البيع مثل الربا وأحل الله البيع وحرم الربا, فالقرآن الكريم فرق بين حقيقتين, حقيقة الربا وحقيقة البيع, وأن الربا حرام وأن البيع حلال. وحقيقة البيع تختلف عن حقيقة الربا, ولذلك اختلفا في الحكم. وإن كانوا متفقين في الصورة وفي الحقيقة لابد أن يتفقا في الحكم. فقرر القرآن الكريم أن البيع حلال والربا حرام, ثم يأتي بعد ذلك ما هي الحكمة, ما هي العلة. القرآن الكريم حدد أن العلة التي يبنى عليها الحكم هي أن البيع نفسه هذا حلال والربا بوصفه هذا حرام, لكن الحكمة أنه الربا فيه ظلم فقد ندركه وقد لا ندركه, وعلينا أن نجتهد حتى ندرك هذا الظلم. والبيع الأصل فيه المنفعة للطرفين, وخالي وكونه حلال فهو خالي من الظلم. فيما يتعلق بالنقطة الثانية اللي تفضلت بها وهي قضية التكلفة, من وجهة نظري الشخصية هذه قضية مهمة جدا, وهو أنه لا ينبغي لشركات التمويل الإسلامية والبنوك الإسلامية أن تستغل إقبال الناس إليها وترفع السعر مقابل ذلك, خاصة عندما تكون شركة التمويل أو البنك الإسلامي واحد أو متفرد بسوق التمويل, فحال الناس في التعامل معه كأنهم مضطرون للحرص على الشريعة. فهنا يجب أن يكون في مستوى أخلاقي معين حتى لا يستغل إقبال الناس ويرفع عليهم السعر, لأنهم مقبلون ومضطرون للتعامل الشرعي. فيجب على شركات التمويل الإسلامية أن تكون عندها حساسية تجاه هذه النقطة, وهي ألا تستغل عاطفة الناس وإقبال الناس عليها وترفع السعر. من ناحية واقعية, هل يوجد داع لأن يكون التمويل الإسلامي أعلى في السعر من التمويل الربوي؟ واقع الحال يقول لا يوجد داعي, حتى في المشرق العربي الدول الإسلامية عموما هناك ضوابط تحكم عملية التمويل, ضوابط رقابية من السلطات الإشرافية. فالمتاح للبنك الإسلامي هو نفسه المتاح للبنك التقليدي أو العكس, بمعنى أنه ما يتيحه البنك المركزي والسلطات الإشرافية المختلفة من نواحي رقابية ومن حيث الأسعار وما يتعلق بالرقابة على الائتمان نفسه هو مشترك وموحد. فما في شيء صعب على الشركة الإسلامية بالمقارنة بالشركة التقليدية. فإذا ليس للشركة الإسلامية أو للبنك الإسلامي أن يدعي بأنه في وضع مختلف. عندما يكون هناك حاجة فعلية, هذه النقطة الأخيرة في هذه القضية, عندما تكون هناك حاجة فعلية بأن هناك تكلفة لا يتحملها البنك التقليدي, ففي هذه الحالة أنا أنصح أن تتحملها الشركة الإسلامية بأقل التكاليف بالأكتوال كوست أو التكلفة الفعلية على يعني وإذا كان شيء بسيط زيادة أو بدون زيادة هو الأفضل حتى لا تتهم الشركة الإسلامية بأنها تستغل العاطفة الدينية لدى المجتمع المسلم وتربح من هذه القضية.
جزاك الله خير. Thank you so much. Very important points. I would like to ask Brother Abdulrahman to summarize it in English. We have brothers and sisters following us and they want to understand it well, inshallah. So please, Abdulrahman, if you can, please summarize it in English.
Inshallah. I hope I will remember everything because there is a lot, mashallah, that was said by Dr. Abdulbari.
He was talking about you or your company to take care of your customers.
Yes. Okay, that is a given, inshallah. But let me go back to the beginning of Dr. Abdulbari's comments and then I guess his answer to the specific question about are Islamic banks or Islamic financing companies more expensive than conventional banks. So Dr. Abdulbari started his talk by stating the ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وقالوا إنما البيع مثل الربا وأحل الله البيع وحرم الربا. In this ayah, it's clearly there is a differentiation between a trade transaction, buying and selling, and between a riba transaction. So if we understand the difference between the two, then we will understand why is it halal or why is this halal and why is that haram. Bay' or the trade transaction should produce benefit to both parties, to the seller as well as to the buyer, and there is a sense of equality in the transaction. However, the transaction of riba is actually less productive, and there is unfair side of the riba transaction, which may be the reason why riba is haram. So I hope I hope I summarized the points well enough, inshallah.
Jazakallah. Thank you. Thank you.
Taklifa. When it comes to the pricing, Dr. Abdulbari mentioned in a nutshell that there is or there should be no reason for Islamic banking or Islamic finance companies to claim that their costs are higher than conventional banking. And the reason for that is because the source of the financing and the regulations and the policies are the same and they are equal for both arms, the conventional arm as well as the Islamic arm. And therefore, it should not be claimed that the cost is higher and therefore they offer their product at a higher price. Definitely, Islamic banks and Islamic financing companies should never manipulate the market where they become only one source of financing for the Muslim community. And because the Muslim community is sincere enough to seek such product that they actually end up taking advantage of that. As a matter of fact, if they are faced with that, then the cost or the extra cost that has to be incurred by the Islamic banking organizations should be given out to customers either at cost or maybe with a very small margin on top of that. And then finally, he concluded his talks by making a recommendation for Islamic companies and Islamic financing providers to take care of their customers and not to take advantage of them.
Jazakallah.
So, but if I may add very small point to that, because I think it's very beneficial actually to everyone. So I can speak about Islamic finance providers in the US, whereas I cannot really speak about Islamic banks overseas. And the reason for that is, depending on the country where the Islamic bank is located, whether that country supports Islamic finance with its regulations and policies and central bank procedures or not, it actually kind of makes a difference for the bank's operation on that side. Now, when we come to the U.S. specifically, and the U.S. does not recognize Islamic finance as means of finance, okay, meaning, okay, the regulations, the policies, everything is done to sustain and to support conventional transactions, okay? And therefore, for the Islamic players to come into this space and try to offer a special product, you have extra costs associated with that. And I can simplify those costs, or just to mention one or two examples, you have to have Sharia boards, okay, with experts from the actual industry. They act as your advisor. They are independent. Their opinions are independent, but they do act as your advisors. If you want to fulfill the IOFI standards, then you have to have an internal Sharia department or governance department as well to make sure that your operations and your procedures and your process meets the standards set by IOFI for Islamic finance standards. And then also you have to hire legal firms in order to draft new contracts that are different than the conventional contracts, as well as to get licensed in every state that you operate within. So those things, as examples, are extra costs that has to be borne by Islamic finance providers versus conventional providers. And to conclude the point here, I can tell you from my personal experience, having worked with two companies so far in this arena for the past about 16 or 17 years or so, I can tell you that there is a continuous effort from the organization side to be more and more competitive, not just with the direct competition, but also with the indirect competition, such as large banks, conventional banks, despite the differences and despite the inequality in terms of volume and in terms of procedures and process. If you compare UIF's pricing today to any other Islamic finance provider or non-Islamic finance provider, I'm very sure that you will be satisfied and that you will be very happy. And to the point of Dr. Abdulbari, shall we take care of our customers? Absolutely. We actually pride ourselves to handhold our customers throughout the process, one step at a time, so that they understand and comprehend exactly what is coming their way, and so that we can have a end up with a happy customer at the end of the road. Alhamdulillah, UIF was blessed to be voted number one Islamic finance provider in the US 6 years in a row, which is quite an accomplishment.
May Allah bless you and bless all companies, those who are working for our communities, those who are working hard to give us the alternative, the halal way, inshallah. Sure. Now, I have some sensitive questions. Please forgive me, Brother Abdulrahman and Dr. Abdulbari, because I'm trying to give you some common questions, some common concerns from people. And I really appreciate all brothers and sisters, those who are joining us now on Facebook. Please share this now, this lecture with your friends, and put your questions now here in the comment. We will go through it, inshallah, very quick. We'll have, inshallah, short answers, short questions and short answers very quick, inshallah. Now, Brother Abdulrahman, again, then I will ask Dr. Abdulbari, how do you calculate your profit, if we call it profit? Or
yes.
So how do you calculate it?
That's a very good question, and it's a very common question. And before I answer that, I want to state that there is no such thing as sensitive question, because people have the right to understand how things are being structured and what they are dealing with. Okay, we do calculate our profits based on benchmarking against the interest rate schedules that are in the market. And we do that for several reasons. I will just list probably three of them. Number one, when you operate within certain industry, then you are obligated to follow the structure of that industry from process, regulations, and from pricing structure as well. We do not have an Islamic index available today so that we can follow that, right, and be able to implement that in the US. So that's number one. So if you are in the cars business, for example, you will price your cars against the car market. You're not going to price your cars against the train markets, for example, right? Or if you are in certain commodity, you're going to price against that commodity. So that's number one. Number two, we also do that so that we are competitive in the market. So our pricing is not off, too far off from what is being offered in a conventional bank or in a conventional brokerage or lender, basically, right? So you have to have some type of benchmark to be able to do that. And number three is because we are very confident about the structure of our contracts, okay? So even making a profit based on a percentage does not really make it interest, okay? So having a profit based on percentage does not make it interest. It's based on calculations, based on the type of transaction that you are engaged in. And maybe it's worth to mention the three types of financing available today, at least for real estate. The first one is musharaka, which is the most common one. The second one is ijara, which is lease to own. So musharaka is co-partnership or partnership programs. The second one is lease to own or ijara. And the third one is murabaha or installment sale. Because the profits are driven from the structure of these contracts, therefore, they are actually different than interest, even though they may look the same on the surface and what have you. And the last point that I want to mention to this is it's also done this way so that our customers can take benefit and advantage of the home ownership benefits that they get from the government, from the federal government, by simply writing off the profits paid if it's an Islamic finance product, or interest paid if it's a conventional finance product, basically.
Jazakallah khair. Again, I want to understand more, as our brothers and sisters here, you call it a profit rate, okay? Bank calls it interest rate. Isn't the same thing or not? If Dr. Abdulbari or Brother Abdulrahman.
Tamam. الناتج عن عملية البيع يقال له profit. يقال له ربح. والناتج عن عملية القرض يقال له فائدة. قد يكون هناك قدر من التشابه بينهما في الحساب وفي الشكل، وقد يكون أيضا في طريقة الدفع، ولكن نشأة الربح تنشأ عن عملية مختلفة اللي هي قلنا هي البيع أو الإيجار، والفائدة تنشأ عن عملية القرض. فإذا النشأة مختلفة والشكل متشابه، فما نشأ عن عملية البيع ربح، وما نشأ عن عملية القرض فائدة، يتشابهان في الشكل لكن في الحقيقة المنشئة لكل واحد منهما مختلفة. وهذا الذي جعل أهل الجاهلية يقولون إنما البيع مثل الربا، يقول البيع مثل الربا، لم يقولوا الربا مثل البيع، حتى قالوا البيع مثل الربا، الحلال مثل الحرام. فقرر الله تعالى في القرآن الكريم أن الحقائق مختلفة، هذا بيع وهذا ربا كما تحدثنا في المقدمة. فبالتالي المصطلح يعود إلى النشأة.
نعم. طيب أستاذ عبد الرحمن، you are our translator today.
Inshallah, no problem. So Dr. Abdulbari is differentiating. Well, first of all, the question is, we call it profit rate. Conventional banks call it interest rate. Aren't they really the same? And the answer to that is very simple. As Dr. Abdulbari just mentioned, that to differentiate between the two, you have to reference back to the origin of the production, meaning, you know, what produced this profit rate and what produced what we call fa'ida or interest in the conventional terms. You will find out that even though they may be very similar in result, you know, mathematically speaking, you know, whether you finance a home at 3% interest rate or 3% profit rate, the actual math is the same. So the ending result is the same. Okay, and there are many similarities in the way these payments are made and in the way of the actual calculation. So from that perspective, they are very similar and they look the same. However, you know, the special characteristics which differentiates each one of these two, you know, productions or ending result is the inception of the two results. So the inception of trade is actually trade, and it's based on one of the structures allowed and permitted by Sharia. However, the inception of riba is the loan, the qard, which is not allowable, right? And therefore, the ending result is haram or it's riba, which differentiates the two from each other. So therefore, there are many similarities in the way they look and the actual ending results from a mathematical perspective, but they are completely different when it comes to their special characteristics based on the way that transaction was initiated, so to speak. So I guess that's in a nutshell what
Jazakumullah khairan.
Brothers and sisters, please just wait, be patient with us. We will go through your questions, inshallah. Just put your question in the comment, inshallah. I will go through it very quick, inshallah. Just give us 5 more minutes, then we'll leave the last 10 or 15 minutes for your questions, inshallah ta'ala. This question also, Brother Abdulrahman, since you are working with UIF, how does one qualify and work with UIF?
So the main qualifications for a customer would really come down to three main things, and this is really based on more of a mortgage knowledge than anything else, which they call it the three C's: capacity, credit, and collateral. Capacity, credit, and collateral. When it comes to capacity, that basically refers to your down payment and your income, verification of income. And most of the time, the company would look, any financier would actually look at your future, your current income, your past 2 years of income, and then your upcoming 3 years of income to establish stability and to establish capacity. Then the second C, which is credit. So they would also look at your credit to make sure that your credit is good, or that you have been fulfilling your obligations on time and there are no delays or anything like that. And a lot of people actually would argue, well, if you're using credit, then it must not be Islamic. And the truth to that is actually it's quite the opposite, because Islam requires us to fulfill our obligations, our wa'ud. We have to fulfill our promises, right? And your credit is almost like your history, your reputation history in the past, right? And then the third component, which is the collateral, then we look at the actual the actual house that you are buying to make sure that it's, you know, within the market price, it's evaluated as decent or as average, and there are other requirements that has to do with it. So those three C's are the main components. Now, to get to practicality, okay, all you need to do is visit our website, myuif.com, or call one of our representatives. You get pre-qualified, and pre-qualified means they take some initial information from you, simple information as first name, last name, social security number, stuff like that. They run your credit to make sure that your credit is okay. They take your employment history. It's all really done over the phone, or you can do it online as well through, Qualify Now. It only takes about 5 to 10 minutes or so. And then once you are pre-qualified, that pre-qualification gives you power of attorney. So in other words, to engage in any of the three transactions, whether it's ijara or murabaha or musharaka, you need to have power of attorney from the company to act on their behalf in negotiating the price, selecting the house, and signing the sales contract. Okay. And then the second step would be taking the application, then you go through the process and you close your transaction.
Jazakallah. Thank you, Brother Abdulrahman. Brother, there is brother here with us on Facebook. He's following us. His name is DE Guy. Please drive safely. He said, I wish I could talk as well. I'm driving. It's dangerous. I have to write. If I get in an accident and die, please pray for me.
La hawla wa quwwata illa billah. You should not do that.
May Allah bless you. Drive safely, please. And we are so happy and glad to that you are with us, listening to us. Please put your questions later on. And inshallah, after the session or now, inshallah, you will hear the answers. And later on, inshallah, Brother Dr. Abdulbari and Brother Abdulrahman will go through all your comments and your questions to answer, inshallah, as well. I will have the last question from my side now. Then we'll go through the questions from brothers and sisters, because we promised them to go through their questions, inshallah ta'ala. You said murabaha and ijara. What difference between Dr. Abdulbari murabaha and ijara? Can we have an idea between the difference between murabaha and ijara?
في المرابحة أو في كلا الصيغتين مرابحة أو الإجارة شركة التمويل تملك الأصل، ثم في المرابحة تملك الأصل بالبيع مباشرة، بينما في الإجارة تؤجر مع وعد بالتمليك في نهاية فترة الإجارة، فيبقى الأصل على ملكية الممول شركة التمويل فترة سنين أو عمر التمويل بالكامل. فمخاطر الأصل، مخاطر هلاك الأصل خلال فترة التمويل تكون على الشركة أو على الممول في الإجارة، بينما مخاطر هلاك الأصل في المرابحة من لحظة البيع تنتقل إلى العميل المشتري.
جزاك الله. يلا يا مستر عبد الرحمن، بارك الله فيك.
إن شاء الله. So the question is, what is the difference between إجارة, the model إجارة or lease to own, and مرابحة, which is the installment sale? And I'm just going to add one more, which is مشاركة, partnership program, okay. Just to make it a little bit more comprehensive for everybody. And the difference, as Dr. Abdulbari mentioned, is that In both transactions, ijara or lease to own, and murabaha, which is the installment sale, the company or the financier must own the property. So they must purchase the property. In the ijara transaction, they will own it and keep title during the entire financing period until it is paid off. Then there is a promise from the buyer to end up buying the property at the end from the seller, which exactly what happens at the end of the term, whether it's 15, 20, or 30 years. The risk associated with maybe demolition of the property or a sabotage that may take place with the property or damages, the risk lies with the owner, which is the financier, and the lease-to-own model. However, on the installment sale model, once the financier buys and owns the property, then they end up marking up their profit, reselling the property or conveying ownership to the buyer. So in that sense, the risk of demolishment or the risk of damages lies on the consumers or on the customers' shoulders. Why? Because the transfer of ownership happened immediately after the acquisition of the property at the initial stage of it. When it comes to title, it does convey right away, either through, for UIF, at least through power of attorney, and some other organizations, they can also do two different closings back to back when it comes to Murabaha. Now, my addition, which was not covered by Dr. Abdulbari, is the partnership. And in the partnership, it is a little bit different because both parties come to the table with their own shares of funds, and they both close on that transaction as co-owners or as partners in that property. For legal purposes and also to avoid tax implications on the customer, most financiers who adopt this model do not allow their name to go on title purposely to avoid any type of transfer taxes or anything like that. Now, with this model, the risk of demolishment and the risk of damages actually lies on both parties alike, or not alike, but in both parties based on their ownership percentage in the property. So I hope I covered the...
Jazakallah khair. Jazakallah. Thank
you. Jazakallah khairan.
MashaAllah. We are here, inshallah, to help everyone to understand well how these things work, inshallah ta'ala, and that will depend of each one of us will decide to go or to go to other choice. May Allah Azza wa Jal provide us all, inshallah ta'ala, good and barakah in our life, inshallah ta'ala. Now, Sister Nadia said, assalamu alaikum. Please, Dr. Abdulbari and Brother Abdulrahman, read with me the comments here and questions, and we'll, inshallah, answer their questions very quick. If they have questions here, a business loan is a charitable act. دكتور عبدالباري. البزنس لون يعتبر من أعمال الصدقة أو من أعمال الخيرية؟
يعني هنا السؤال، البزنس لون يعني القرض التجاري هل هو من أعمال الصدقة؟ هو أصل القرض، نحن نوضح هنا المصطلح، استخدام المصطلح. لا نقول عن التمويل الإسلامي إسلاميك لون، نقول إسلاميك فاينانس، وبعد ذلك يكون إما مرابحة أو إجارة أو مشاركة، فهو إسلاميك فاينانس. في الكونفنشنال نقول لون، انترست لون يعني، أو البزنس لون. في الإسلام لا يوجد بزنس لون، يوجد تشيرتابل لون يعني قرض حسن، قرض حسن. فالمتوفر في الإسلام إنه إنسان يمنح أخاه يعني قرضا بغرض الثواب بدون فائدة، يمنح أخاه قرضا بدون فائدة. فهذا الأمر لا يتيسر أن يكون عملا عاما، وإنما هو عمل خاص لبعض الناس وعلى مستوى ضيق. بالتقليدي أو بالصناعة الربوية حولوا القرض من عمل خيري إلى عمل تجاري، فأضافوا له الانترست أو الفائدة. عندنا في الإسلام القرض عمل خيري بحت، والعمل التجاري هو تحت مظلة البيع، مظلة شاملة، مظلة البيع، وتشمل في المفهوم الفقهي تشمل كل صور المعاوضات من بيع وإجارة والقروض، حتى المشاركة يمكن أن تدخل بالمفهوم العام لذلك. الخلاصة أنه نعم، نحن في الإسلام لا يوجد لدينا قرض تجاري، بمعنى أنه واحد يمنح القرض بغرض الحصول على عائد تجاري لأنه هذا ربا، وإنما يمنح القرض بغرض الحصول على ثواب من الله تعالى.
سيد عبد الرحمن، summarize it please.
إن شاء الله. So again, there is no such thing as a charitable loan, a charitable business loan. As a matter of fact, there is no such thing in Islamic finance altogether. So there's a difference between Islamic finance and loans, which is the method adopted in the conventional banking system, basically. So the word loan in Islam is simply a charitable act. So qard hasan is an amount that you borrow and you return it back the same amount. You cannot, you know, return it back with more, or in some opinions, or less even. So the difference between the two is that in Islamic finance, there are certain means, which is trading in so many different ways to do it, mudaraba or other than mudaraba, so that two people can come together and partner up in a transaction for the purpose of profit. But you cannot, you know, that if you lend somebody money to get interest back, okay, and they can do business with that money, it's not charitable, because this is actually haram. Why? Because it creates interest, which is the prohibition in Islam. So therefore, the main difference between the two is in one model, it's lending and borrowing transaction. In the other model, Islamic finance model, it is means to do business with each other.
Okay, Jazakallah khair, Sayyid Abdul Rahman. Now, from the same brother, DEE, Jazakallah khair, drive safely again. He is asking, Assalamu alaikum, are there any halal loans available for people trying to start business? I think from Abdul Rahman's side, if you have this any service.
We don't have halal loans, but we have halal financing for businesses, actually. So, yes, at UIF, we do have a commercial finance arm that operates to finance mainly real estate commercial business. And to differentiate for people, commercial real estate is anything that is 5 units or more, or more than 4 units, and residential is 4 units or less that are sold together under the same parcel. And same parcel means same title, or same piece of land, basically, such as duplexes or fourplexes and, you know, stuff like that. There are other lines of businesses that we also finance, such as, you know, dental offices, doctor's offices, small clinics, hospitals, and such. We do not, however, engage in anything that's environmental, such as, you know, gas stations, oil changes, stuff like that. We avoid that because the risk is obviously higher. But please visit our website, request to speak to somebody from the commercial department or commercial arm, and I'm very sure they'll be more than happy to discuss the potential business with you.
Okay, there is another question. How do I get approval for a loan?
It's very simple. Again, please go visit our website, apply online. There are different ways and different options that you can do that online. All you'll be asked is to enter a few basic information, and then you will be followed up with somebody who is licensed and specialized to help you and take you through the transaction, inshallah.
Okay, and here other question. Bismillah. Let me post it here. Can you see it, Brother Abdulrahman?
Yes.
Okay. Personal loans to people in need are charitable acts, but not business loan. If person has home, capital, and person B has experience, please, if you can answer this question.
Okay, so I will translate this question to Dr. Abdulbari, because I think it's probably a better answer would come from Dr. Abdulbari. Okay. Basically, it says a personal loan to people in need are charitable acts. القروض بين الناس أو إلى الناس التي في حاجة هو موضوع charitable
موضوع
خيري نعم موضوع خيري ولكن لا ينطبق هذا على العقود أو اللونز القروض اللي بهدف البزنس أو بهدف الأعمال إقامة الأعمال if شخص ما has some capital and person B has experience. لو هناك شخصين، الشخص الأول عنده الفلوس والشخص الثاني عنده الخبرة أو الجهد يعني has experience and person A lends this money. الشخص الأول يقرض هذه الأموال أو هذه المبالغ to person B إلى الشخص الثاني to invest it for him and get interest or profit in return. There is a lot of mix here in the question because he's asking if person A lends the money to person B and then let person B invest that money to him to pay him back interest or profit. Is this simply halal or haram?
هو بارك الله فيكم أستاذ عبد الرحمن. هو خلط يعني في المصطلحات يعني استخدم مصطلحات يعني غير دقيقة. هو يتكلم عن صورة المضاربة الشرعية. شخص لديه رأس مال وآخر لديه خبرة وعمل فيستطيع أن يقدم من لديه رأس المال إلى صاحب الخبرة ويقتسمان الربح بنسبة معينة فيقتسمان الربح المحتمل المتوقع وليس الانترست لا يقتسمان الربح فليس هو لون وليس هو انترست وإنما هو في رأس مال واقتسام الربح بنسبة معينة وإذا حصلت خسارة يكون على صاحب رأس المال.
So the answer to the question that is that there is a mix in the usage of terminology in the question. We have to differentiate between the term loan, which is قرض, and the term مضاربة, which is a permissible means to do business in Islam. Dr. Abdulbari thinks that the person who is asking the question is really asking about mudaraba, which is exactly what he mentioned. One person has the money or the capital, the second person has the experience and the know-how to run the business. So person A invests his money with person B and not lends his money to person B. There's a huge difference between the two. So if person A invests the money with person B, let person B run the business for him at a percentage of the actual profit that is agreed upon between the two parties. So they can share profits, but they cannot share the capital. Why? Because the capital belongs to the owner of the capital originally. However, also in a loss situation, the loss goes to the capital owner and not to the mudarib, which is the second person that's actually running the business.
نعم. ما شاء الله بارك الله
جزاك الله خير عبد الرحمن. الآن من سؤال أو يعني تعليق من إحدى الأخوات الفاضلات الأستاذة غالية: من المؤسف أن البنك الإسلامي في أمريكا بيدفع الناس أكثر من البنك العادي ولكن بالتلاعب بالألفاظ، هل هذه الفكرة كما هي عند الكثير من الناس هي بالفعل أمر واقع ولا في هناك حقائق تغيب عنا ككاستمرز وممكن معرفتها الآن من فضيلة يعني الدكتور الشيخ عبد الباري مشعل أو الأستاذ عبد الرحمن الخبير في المؤسسة هذه؟ نعم،
أنا أرى أنه نقسم الإجابة بيني وبين الأستاذ عبد الرحمن.
تفضل.
يعني لابد أن
باختصار الآن 45 minutes ما شاء الله and we need to go through all the questions إن شاء الله very quick.
الأمر هذا في ظل المنافسة الأخيرة بين الشركات الإسلامية في أمريكا تقريباً أوشك على الانتهاء. يعني هذا هو قضية تحميل العميل تكلفة أعلى، وأنا نبهت إلى هذه النقطة ببداية اللقاء اليوم أو ببداية يعني هذا البث، إنه من المهم ألا تستغل حاجة وعاطفة العميل للتعامل مع الإسلام. الشركات الإسلامية عموماً في أمريكا بعضها مر بهذا الشيء اللي أنا أنتقده، وهذا مر أيضاً في المشرق، ولكن كان حل واقعياً هو المنافسة. لما حصلت المنافسة في سوق حر انخفضت الأسعار بشكل عام وتحسنت الجودة فوجهة نظري أنا الآن المشكلة ليست في بالصورة التي تطرحها الأخت في سؤالها، بدت أخف بكثير وأنا أبدو مرتاحا أكثر للصورة الحالية، يعني بعد المنافسة القوية التي حصلت بين الشركات الإسلامية. دائما المنافسة تأتي بخير لطرف العملاء وهذا حصل، وممكن نسمع وجهة نظر الأستاذ عبد الرحمن من واقع السوق يعني تجاه هذه النقطة.
So that competition was good, الحمد لله رب العالمين, and the companies they have to say استغفر الله 10 times and they will start over. بسم الله أستاذ عبد الرحمن.
بسم الله استغفر الله سبحانه وتعالى. So Dr. Abdulbari was mentioning that, you know, these practices may have happened in the past or in the, let's say, near history. For Islamic banks and Islamic financiers, whether they are based here in the U.S. or actually overseas.
However, sorry, Abdulrahman, to interrupt you. The question again from that sister saying, just to know the question about what? Yes.
Oh, the question, I'm sorry. So the question is, there is a general practice that Islamic financiers or Islamic finance providers in the U.S. push people to pay more by utilizing and using different terminologies that may not be very clear to the average consumer. So the answer to that was, Dr. Abdulbari started by pointing out that in the beginning of this session, we talked about the recommendation where Islamic finance providers should be competitive and should not take advantage of people because they are seeking a niche product that serves their financial and principal needs. Perhaps in the past, when you look at the history of Islamic finance providers in the US, there might have been some of these practices. And actually, when you look at the history, and this is really from experience, Islamic finance in the US probably started in the mid to late 80s with the inception of La Riba, as one of the pioneers in this industry, and then later on other companies came about. So you know, and historically speaking, there might have been some of these practices, whether it's overseas or here in the U.S. However, Dr. Abdulbari thinks that in the past 5 or 6 years, competition has risen between these companies, and therefore that drove two things to happen. Number one, improve on quality of products, and number two, having companies compete to be more competitive and closer to where the pricing in that market should be. I hope I
رأيك الآن. الآن your experience.
Now, from my personal experience, so there are really two folds to this, to be fair, okay? And again, I always would love to differentiate between Islamic banks and Islamic financiers overseas and Islamic financiers in the US. As a matter of fact, I will go even one step further and differentiate even within the US between Islamic or between banks that are providing this type of finance product and between financial companies that are providing this type of product. Why do I differentiate between the two? Because the rules and the regulations which apply to each party is a little bit different than the other. So it's kind of unfair to couple all of them or to gather all of them under the same umbrella. So overseas pricing, I'm not going to cover that because I don't have the experience on it, but yes, definitely there was a reputation, ongoing reputation that they were taking advantage of people and that the pricing was more expensive and so on and so forth. But the real history in the US here is that when Islamic finance incepted in the US, the volume was very insignificant when compared to larger organizations who are doing this year in and year out and day in and day out. Okay, it's almost, if you want to compare, it's almost like having a Walmart that's getting certain supply for the Walmart chain, over 600 or 700 stores nationwide, and a small mom and pop shop that's trying to carry the same type of products. And we know the story. When Walmart came to business, it drove so many different smaller, mom and pop shops out of business. Why? Because they had an advantage of the volume. They had an advantage of getting better pricing at the entry level for the organization. Same thing really happened for Islamic finance providers here in the US. And not just that, right? Actually, their costs were also higher because, as I mentioned in the beginning of this presentation, that they have extra costs when it comes to Sharia governing, for example, having an independent Sharia board that act as advisors, when it comes to licensing, when it comes to drafting, all these documents and redrafting all these documents, you have legal costs and you have also extra compliance costs. Why? Because your process is unique than the process that's being offered in the conventional market. However, I do agree with Dr. Abdulbari that as competition heats up, and as more players come into play, that definitely forces Islamic finance management or companies management to drive the pricing down so that they can compete fairly and also to increase their quality of products. So I'm totally in agreement with Dr. Abdulbari. But also there is another side which is unknown or unseen by a regular customer, is that also it's based on the structure of the product itself. In other words, okay, take for example the product Musharaka, okay, Musharaka or partnership. It is offered today by three different organizations. Okay, I will talk about only our organization because I do not want to talk negatively or bash competition. But when it comes to this partnership program, it was adopted and incepted by UIF about a year ago or so. It is actually consuming over 80% of our, or maybe 90% of our transactions today. And in our transaction or in our Musharaka model, we do not have what's called LLC, Limited Liability Corporation, that is being offered by other Islamic finance providers. And there is a charge, a monthly charge that comes associated with it. Okay. This LLC structure has nothing to do with Sharia whatsoever. Okay. It has everything to do with certain legal and benefit that actually goes back to the company, not to the customer, as a matter of fact. Yet there is a cost associated with it that the customer ends up paying for, okay? So these are the type of things that should be avoided and should be improved upon and should be fixed for the greater benefit of our customers and our community.
Jazakallah, thank you.
تمام, أنا أضيف نقطة صغيرة. أريد أن أوافق الأستاذ عبد الرحمن بأنه هناك يعني مسوغات أو مبررات موضوعية معقولة مقبولة للشركات الإسلامية تأخذ ربح أعلى، كما قال أنه في هناك وظائف وأعمال غير موجودة بالكونفنشنال، الهيئة الشرعية، التدقيق الشرعي، فهذه تكلفة لا يتحملها الكونفنشنال، فقط الشركات الإسلامية بتتحملها، فلا بد أنه هي تضيفها على تكلفة التمويل كي تستردها. النقطة الثانية أنه شركات التمويل الإسلامية بتتحمل مخاطر أو ريسك تملك الأصل، وهذا من الناحية الفنية البحتة اللي هي البزنس تبرر الربح الأكثر. ولكن مع ذلك، مع وجود هذين الأمرين، أنا أرى أن المنافسة بين الشركات الإسلامية والبنوك الإسلامية أدت إلى تخفيض التكلفة بشكل مساوي إلى الـ conventional finance.
Very good. Very good point. Yeah, two points. If Brother Abdurrahman can summarize it, very important to know that. Inshallah, this answer for Sister Ghalia Kaftaro, her question and her comment. So now Brother Abdurrahman and Dr. Abdulbari, they are talking not only on their behalf of their company or the company of UIF. I think now the answer on behalf of all Islamic companies. So Brother Abdurrahman, just please summarize these two points. Then I will post the questions here in front of you just to say for the question yes or no, very quick.
Inshallah. So in summary, what Dr. Abdulbari is mentioning is that he agrees with one part of my answer, that yes, absolutely, there are extra jobs and or additional jobs, additional functions, which Islamic finance would have to adopt in order to make their product Sharia compliant. And also from a different perspective, that there are extra costs also associated. معلش, I forgot the second
point. تملك الأصل.
نعم. There is another point, which is the share of risk, or really it's risk mitigation on the on behalf of the actual organization. Okay. So these are two main factors that drive higher prices sometimes and higher costs. But even with that, what has been witnessed, at least in the past 5 years in this industry, is that despite these two drivers to higher pricing, Islamic finance providers were actually forced to be more competitive in terms of price, not just to compete with each other, but actually to compete with other conventional banks as well. So the one point that I'm going to add that's not mentioned by Dr. Abdulbari is that is very true, but that also cuts into the margins of the profits that these companies are making, right? And therefore, you know, sustainability here is a whole different subject that can be discussed separately.
Jazakallah. Thank you, Abdurrahman, and thank you, Dr. Abdulbari, to complete the idea and to complete the answer in, alhamdulillah, in proper way. May Allah bless you, inshallah, increase you in knowledge and accept from you. Now, question from Brother Muhammad Akhtar. Assalamu alaikum. Can I refinance my loan with interest from another mortgage company to you? What will be the procedure?
The answer is yes, and the most direct and simple answer is please go to www.myuif.com and apply online and request refinance, and a specialized licensed individual will give you a call back and take your information and take you through the process.
Good. Other question from Brother Muhammad Golid. I have, please, if you, Brother Abdurrahman, can you read the question?
Yes, sure. I have a conventional loan with an Islamic financing company. Does this mean it is riba? The answer is no. If it's from another Islamic financing company, it doesn't mean that it's riba. If they have the correct and the proper credentials in place, okay? And the most simple ones that I could mention is perhaps either an independent Sharia board or some type of reference from a scholar who reviewed their documents and approved it based on our Islamic principles. And if they also have some type of Sharia governance, then no, it should not be an interest product. It should be actually halal. we do not go around trying to bash other than say they are not halal and we are halal. We don't do that. Does this mean it's riba? No. How does Murabaha works in the sense of Islamic financing? Can we say that some Islamic financing companies change the term interest to a profit? I think we covered that again, you know, previously, where we differentiated between the inception of interest versus the inception of trade or buy, you know, selling and buying. So no, if it's Murabaha, true Murabaha, if it's true Musharaka, if it's true Ijara, then the ending result is actually profit and not interest.
Okay, Jazakallah khair. And I think we cover this question as well from Brother D. Do you also offer halal business loan? We have the question here from Sister Hijazi. What I don't understand is the condition of paying rent alongside mortgage payments instead of just buying the house at a higher price from the Islamic bank. I agree with the previous question about replacing the word interest. Okay.
So this, just to make a quick comment about this, the sister here is asking that she does not really understand the difference between paying, you know, a long rent, you know, something in addition to rent versus, you know, basically paying a higher price from an Islamic bank, and therefore both of them are the same. And I will reference back to the ayah that Dr. Abdulbari mentioned in the beginning of the session, that وَقَالُوا إِنَّمَا الْبَيْعُ مِثْلُ الرِّبَى. And the answer is very clear. أَحَلَّ الْبَيْعَ وَحَرَّمَ الْرِبَى. These are two completely different transactions, even though they look the same at the ending result, which is the mathematical result, but the characteristics of each process is completely different to get to that ending result.
Okay, Jazakallah khair. As long as we are staying away from interest, Alhamdulillah, I'm good. So, inshallah, may Allah Azza keep us all good, inshallah ta'ala, away from haram. Here, Brother Basim Aliwa, good job, Dr. Abdulbari Mashal, and he sent you love. So, okay, now we have... Yes, Sister Hijazi again, are Islamic loans typically more expensive than... So I think we covered this question. Here, other question, brother, are there any halal business... Oh, again, this is the same question from brother. He is asking for halal business loan. Please, can you do something like for halal business loan in for some people, they are asking for this?
Can I mean, again, it's not a loan. It's going to be a means of transacting in a way that the company would make profit and the customer would end up getting the results that they're looking for. However, you know, when it comes to business financing or commercial financing, it gets a little bit more tricky. And there are other associated, you know, I guess, rules and underwriting qualifications that that dictates that.
Okay, from Brother Basim. We have specific products in Islamic finance as Murabaha and Ijara, etc. What about this product in conventional banking?
I'm not sure that I understand the question. Is he asking that if a conventional banking or any conventional banks are offering these products? If this is the question, then I guess the answer is no. The players who are operating within this industry are really, you can count them on one hand, literally speaking.
Okay. Sister Jenna, do you purchase...
Dr. Rihabi, المورجج التقليدي, conventional mortgage, ربما يسمى هو يعني تمويل إيجاري. تمويل إيجاري. لكن هو conventional loan. يعني.
Okay.
ما في Islamic إيجارة. وإنما يعني قرض تقليدي.
Okay. Do you purchase and own the house first before any contract with us?
If it's إجارة or مرابحة, the answer is yes. If it's based on مشاركة, then we will own it together from the time that we sign at the closing table.
Okay. Sister Malik said, Assalamu alaikum. Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Here, a question, أخي الكريم, أين تكون البنوك الإسلامية في ميشيغان يرجى الإفادة? Is there Islamic banking there in the Michigan? Brother عبد الرحمن.
So actually, UIF is based in Michigan. It's actually in Southfield, Michigan. However, in this industry, I think most, if not all, the players operate online. So regardless of where you are, if they are operational in the state where you are trying to buy the property, they can actually assist you. So it doesn't have to be in Michigan. Of course, some of them, they do have representatives or offices in different locations. And for UIF specifically, the corporate office actually is based in Southfield, Michigan.
Okay, Sister Malik said, we would like to ask about the promise agreement with details according to scholars, and what are you following?
Okay, I'm going to let actually Dr. Abdulbari elaborate on that, and I'll do the translation. But Dr. Abdulbari, basically, the sister, الأخت تسأل عن ورقة promise to pay, اللي هي our promise agreement. اللي هي بمثابة الصك الدفع أو
البرموسري نوت.
نعم promising note yes promising yes. فتتساءل عن هذه الورقة تحديدا وماذا يقول عنها العلماء وأعتقد هي على أي مدرسة نحن نتبع أي مدرسة يعني.
تمام. تمام طبعا هذا سؤال مهم هنا في أمريكا على وجه الخصوص. هنا في أمريكا ليس لنا حرية كاملة باستعمال بإنشاء واستعمال المستندات التي نريد، خاصة في بيئة ضريبية نريد أن ينتفع العميل من التمويل، وأيضا في نفس الوقت نريد أن نحقق الضمان الكامل المطلوب شرعا لأموال المساهمين، وهو أن العميل يدفع في المواعيد المحددة ونحمي أنفسنا أمام القضاء. البروموسري نوت اللي هو مثل سند إذني أو يعني التزام بالدفع، هذا يصلح في القرض التقليدي ويصلح أيضا وهو مفضل أيضا استخدامه في أمريكا في التمويل الإسلامي. لماذا؟ لأنه هو ورقة قانونية يعتد بها في البيئة القانونية هنا والقضائية، بدل ما أن ننشئ ورقة غير مفهومة وتحتاج إلى خبرة استثنائية في فهمها، نستخدم الورقة اللي مفهومة هنا في البيئة القضائية. فالبروموسيري نوت هو التزام بالدفع مقابل دين شرعي نشأ بالمرابحة أو الإنشاء أو المشاركة أو الإجارة. فهو الفرق بين استخدامه في التمويل الإسلامي واستخدامه في التمويل التقليدي هو أنه يوثق دينا مشروعا في التمويل الإسلامي، وفي التمويل التقليدي يوثق دينا محرما. هذا هو الفرق. فلذلك احنا ليس لدينا اشكال ان نستخدم البروموسري نوت التقليدي لتوثيق دين نشأ بالمرابحة او الإجارة او المشاركة المتناقصة. فكونه هو المستخدم في القرض ليس اشكالا. نحن نتكلم عن ما يسمى وسائل التوثيق. هذه نقطة مهمة، ولو اطلت انا الاستاذ عبد الرحمن هي نفس الفكرة، ولكن أنا أتحدث عنها بجوانب مختلفة. دائما في العقود عندنا العقود الأصلية المرابحة الإجارة المشاركة، وعندنا عقود تابعة لها توثق الالتزامات التي تنشأ بموجبها، مثل عقد الرهن، عقد الكفالة، الشهادة، إثبات الدين كتابته. هذه عبارة عن وسائل مساندة لتوثيق الالتزامات. فالبروميسري نوت هو مجرد ورقة لتوثيق الالتزام مقبولة في البيئة القضائية هنا.
عبد الرحمن, can you summarize it in 10 seconds only?
10 seconds, okay. So to protect the rights and the repay for the investors, a promissory note is actually necessary. It's not really even an option, and it's preferred to be part of the transaction. There are two different types of promissory notes. If the promissory note is used to authenticate and document a transaction which was based on one of the permissible contracts, whether it's murabaha, musharaka, or ijara, then the promissory note becomes a halal document and no problems associated with it. However, if the promissory note is a document to authenticate and document a transaction or a repay of a debt that is based on a conventional loan transaction, then that promissory note becomes an issue because it's authenticating a loan, which is a method that's not permitted to start with. And therefore, the having a promissory note as a secondary document to support the main documents, which are based on murabaha, musharaka, or ijara, should not be an issue whatsoever.
Jazakallah khair. Brother Dadashi Mahnoor said, let's say we buy a house for $100,000. What would be the monthly payment and for what time period?
For these specific questions, I would really suggest that please go to our website, apply, or just call the 800 number, speak to somebody, because it would be a waste of everybody's time to kind of try to cover these specific questions. However, the terms are very standard. So you can finance for 10 years, you can finance for 15 years, you can finance for 20 years, or you can finance for 30 years.
Okay, Jazakallah khair. Brother here doing dua for us, appreciate you, brother. May we hang out in Jannah. Ameen, Ya Rabbil Alameen. Brother Basim here again. I think there is no question with Brother Basim. I want to know a halal business loan. So Brother DE guy, please call. And they might, Brother Abdurrahman, he can might come back to the comments, inshallah, to answer or to reply to you all, inshallah ta'ala.
لكن نصيحة للأخ هنا أن يقول halal business finance.
Halal business finance. Yes, everyone say inshallah for me. May Allah protect us all, inshallah ta'ala. Here, Brother Dr. Muhammad Samur, when you buy a car, you are dealing with merchandise.
Merchandise, yes.
Yes, and the loan comes from either the bank or the dealer itself. Basically, you are not getting money from the bank as a loan or from dealer.
I think the أعتقد أن السائل هنا دكتور يتحدث عن شراء السيارات تحديدا، فهو يقول أن شراء السيارة هو عبارة عن شراء بضاعة، والقرض الذي يأتي لتمويل هذه البضاعة إما أنه يأتي عن طريق البنك مباشرة أو يأتي عن طريق الدار المسؤولة عن بيع هذه السيارة، ولذلك فأنت لست على علاقة مباشرة مع البنك للحصول على هذا القرض. فأعتقد هو يسأل هل هذا يعني حلال أو حرام.
والله أعلم. تمام بارك الله فيكم. صاحب السؤال دكتور سمور، أليس كذلك؟
نعم.
أي نعم. عندما يكون التمويل من الديلر نفسه، يعني الفاينانسر هو الديلر، وهذا موجود في تويوتا وهوندا في قسم التمويل التابع لنفس الشركة، فهذا بيع بالتقسيط مباح. لكن هم بعد ذلك كيف يتعاملوا مع الممول الآخر؟ ربما يكون عندهم هم يعني بنك خاص بهم ويتصرفوا ببيع الدين أو خلافه، نحن لا علاقة لنا بذلك. ما يهمنا أنه الممول هنا هو الديلر نفسه من الشركة الأم، عندها قسم تمويل وهي تمول، وهذا بيع بالتقسيط، كما البلدر في بعض الأحيان هنا في أمريكا يمولك أيضا. فهذه العملية بيع بالتقسيط ولا إشكال فيها من ناحية شرعية.
So there is no problem, inshallah ta'ala. Done with other question?
Do I have 10 seconds to translate this or we'll just move on?
Nine seconds, inshallah.
Okay, so I'll try to be fast. So Dr. Abdulbari is differentiating if the actual financing is acquired through the dealership itself, and this is common with brands like Toyota or Honda and others, then there is no problem with that financing because this is considered as بيع مرابحة in a way, and then whatever transaction that takes place between the dealership and whoever supplies them with the money or pays those loans off is really something that's beyond our responsibility at that point. He said also this is a practice that you can find with certain builders where you can, builders, I guess here is for real estate transactions, where some builders actually offer you larger discounts to finance with them because they have certain structure either internally or again with some backing from other investors to be able to gain the margins from both the sale of the home as well as the financing of the home.
Okay, there is, I think, a good question here. Brother Yusuf Ahmed, assalamu alaikum. Brother, can you see the question, Brother Abdul Rahman?
Yeah. Assalamu alaikum. Where did the Islamic finance get their securities from? If it is provided by Fannie and Freddie, may then how can we justify it?
هذا سؤال مهم وقفزنا عليه يا دكتور رحابي.
نعم. تفضل.
بسم الله. نعم.
تحب أن تعلق أولاً أستاذ عبد الرحمن من الناحية التقنية أو أبدأ من الناحية الشرعية؟
أبدأ من الناحية الشرعية ثم نتبعها بالتقنية إن شاء الله.
هنا في أمريكا لا يمكن لشركات التمويل بحسب حجم رأس مالها أنه هي تمول عدد كبير من البيوت لأنه رأس مال محدود ربما ينتهي بعشر بيوت خاصة التمويل لثلاثين سنة ينتهي بعشر بيوت أو عشرين بيت وبعد ذلك يعني يقف التمويل فلابد أن يكون هناك تمويل للممول نفسه فاللي يحصل في أمريكا أنه فريدي ماك وفيني ماي هي تمول الممول ابتداء أو بعد ذلك بعد أثناء فترة التمويل يقوم شركات التمويل تقوم ببيع الدين إلى فريدي ماك تمام؟ فنحن من ناحية شرعية بيع الدين إلى فريدي ماك هو محل شبهة لا نريد أن ندخل في تفاصيلها شرعا لأنه هي شبهة ربوية ماذا فعلت الشركات الإسلامية؟ الشركات الإسلامية فيما يتعلق بالمرابحة ابتدأت بالحصول على التمويل من اليوم الأول الحصول على التمويل ومن فريدي ماك فأصبحت صورة العملية الممول هو الأصلي هو الممول وشركة الإسلامية بمثابة الوكيل في مستوى المرابحة وهذا أعطى فرصة لشركات التمويل على مستوى المرابحة أنه هي تمول دائما بدون أي إشكال لأنه المال ليس من رأس المال الخاص بالشركة على مستوى الإجارة لا يوجد هذا القيد يمكن إن ترتب هذا الأمر أن تقوم شركة التمويل ببيع خلينا نقول الدين تجاوزا ولكن هي تقوم ببيع الأصل إلى فريدي ماك الأصل لأنه هي تملك قلنا طول فترة التمويل هي تملك الأصل فتقوم ببيعه فينتقل الممول من شركة التمويل الإسلامية إلى فريدي ماك في هذه الحالة ولكن تبقى شركة التمويل الإسلامية هي التي تخدم هذا الدين من خلال التحصيل والمتابعة على مستوى المشاركة أيضا نفس الشيء تستطيع شركة التمويل الإسلامية أن تبيع الدين ولكن طبعا أنا أستخدم لفظ الدين تجاوزا ولكن تبيع الأصل لأنه هي تملك حصة في هذا الأصل اللي هو موضوع التمويل تبيعه في أي وقت إلى فريدي ماك أو فاني ماي ففي هذه الحالة ينتقل حالة الممول تنتقل من الشركة الإسلامية إلى فريدي ماك أو فاني ماي ويتاح فرصة من خلال الحصيلة المتحصلة من بيع الدين السيولة لشركة التمويل الإسلامية أنه هي تمول بيوت مرة ومرة وهكذا وهذا الأمر ضروري هذا الأمر ضروري ليس هناك إشكال هذه إغلاق هذه الفقرة ليس هناك إشكال في التعامل مع فريدي ماك وفيني ماي إذا كان في حدود الشريعة هذا السؤال يأتينا دائما إنه هل أنتم تبيعون الدين إلى فريدي ماك وفيني ماي نعم ولكن في حدود مرتبة من الناحية الشرعية
جزاك الله this we need 20 seconds أشهد رحمة
Inshallah. So Dr. Abdulbari is mentioning that
we still have around 20-25 questions, and we already
I will be as brief as I can, bi-idhnillah. Dr. Abdulbari is mentioning that based on the size of the financial year in the US specifically, and depending on the amount of capital or equity that is designated to finance homes, after financing so many homes, whether it's 10 or 20 or 30, eventually the financier will end up running out of money, and therefore that business will not be scalable. Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae in this situation will become almost like a necessity, really, to provide the liquidity to the financier in order for them to continue to finance homes based on the model that's being adopted by the financier. Dr. Abdulbari also mentioned that there is somewhat of a shubha or argument when it comes to dealing with Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae. We will not get to that for now. But what we need to understand is what did Islamic companies do to solve this issue. So Islamic companies, and I'm going to translate Dr. Abdulbari's here with a little twist of my own, if that's okay, just to get the idea closer at a shorter answer. Those financiers, we have to understand that they're not banks. Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae are not banks. They are enterprises which were established by the Congress in the late 70s for one purpose and one purpose only, which is to promote home ownership in the US. And obviously today, 30-40 years later, home ownership became the main driver of the economy in the US. Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae, the way that they operate is not by lending organizations money. They act as investors to buy loans from a conventional bank. So if you are a conventional bank and you closed a loan, you will go ahead and sell that promissory note to Freddie Mac or Fannie Mae for a return, okay? What Islamic companies did is that they went and said, okay, we want to provide something that's similar to that loan in the way that it looks and in the math and so on and so forth. However, the characteristics and the documents associated with each model, whether it's Murabaha or Musharaka, or in some cases, Ijara, is a little bit different. And if you're gonna act as our investors, then please honor those characteristics and those conditions until the end of the transaction. Make the story short, luckily enough, Freddie Mac actually agreed to do that. And therefore, if the financier, if the company is acting as a broker for a Murabaha transaction, then the main provider of this money or the main financier is actually Freddie Mac or Fannie Mae. And this broker in the middle, or the agent in the middle, which would be the Islamic home finance provider, is working for them for a fee, for a service fee, for a service fee to get paid their money and still remain their liquidity. However, the financier or the company, the middle company, will act and continue to be the agent that's servicing that contract for the entire life of it. When it comes to Musharaka, it's actually not a service fee. It becomes a sell transaction, because as the financier owns shares of this transaction, they are free to sell those shares at any point during the financing, which is exactly what happens in a partnership program or in a Musharaka program.
Jazakallah khair. So many details in these kind of transactions, and may Allah bless you and bless your efforts. Okay, now Sister Dania Hamid, if I buy investment property for cash, after I fix it, I rent it, now I want to get some cash out, how will that work?
That is called cash out refinance. It's a normal transaction. And I think most of the players in the market actually can provide that kind of financing for the customer. However, there is a difference between the regular cash out or conventional cash out and Islamic cash out. And the main difference is in the bay' al-'ina, because you cannot really buy a product for an exchange of cash and resell that product back to the buyer that's called bay al-ayna, which is actually prohibited. So there are means or there are different methods that Islamic financiers adopt in order to solve for that particular issue.
Okay, Sister Umm Malik, again, I think she continue her first question, or this is a separate question. Is the promise, do you see the question?
Is the promise writing? I'm not sure what that means.
I think it related to the previous question. However, Sister Jonquil Bass, Assalamu alaikum, I have an income tax service. Is it haram to offer cash advances from banks that charge interest? My company will not receive any money from the loan on the cash advance for the income tax refund.
هذه هي تساعد في عمليه الحصول على كاش ادفانس من تاكس ريتير، مو هيك استاذ عبد الرحمن؟
نعم،
هي تساعد وتقول لا تحصل على رسوم، والحقيقه هذه المساعده محرمه. يعني ولو كانت تحصل على رسوم لطلبنا منها انه لا تستفيد من هذه الرسوم وانما تتخلص منها.
اوكي.
And the question is, the sister offers tax services where she can request loans from banks, which is, I guess, guaranteed by the actual tax returns for the customer. If she facilitates that service without earning any money off of it, is it halal or haram? And the answer is, even though she does not benefit from facilitating this transaction, to help or to assist somebody perform something haram is still haram. If she was actually earning money from it, the recommendation would be to give up that margin of profits.
Jazakallah khair. Brother Ibrahim Musa, assalamu alaikum. Does UIF have corporate internship?
Yes, please connect with our HR department. We love internships, and there, you know, we love to attract people to this industry. It's a very, very exciting industry where somebody can feel a satisfaction from a spiritual perspective, financial perspective, as well as career perspective, which cannot be said about too many other professions.
Okay, Sister Umm Malik here. هل الوعد بالشراء ملزم قانونا أو أنه التزام وليس ملزما؟
نعم، هنا الأم مالك أعتقد هي سألت قبل ذلك، إحنا أجبنا على البروميسري نوت، هي تسأل عن الوعد بالشراء. هنا واقع الحال الأستاذ عبد الرحمن ممكن يجيبنا، يعني قبل توقيع العقد لو قال العميل هنا في أمريكا، لو قال العميل أنا لم أعد قادرا على الدخول في العقد، ما هو التصرف الذي يمكن أن تقوم به؟ قبل توقيع عقد المرابحة أو توقيع عقد المشاركة أو توقيع عقد الإيجار.
There is no consequences to such act as long as the closing did not actually take place.
نعم، ولذلك نحن نقول هنا في أمريكا الوعد غير ملزم، يعني لا نستطيع أن نلزمه قضاء، لاحظ، لا نستطيع أن نلزمه قضاء بأن يدخل معنا بالعقد. فمجرد ما يقول انه هو لا يرغب لا يكون مصلحتنا حتى ندخل، لا ندخل معه ايضا في متاعب لاحقا، ربما يكون هو تعرض لتغير في الكريديت بوزيشن تبعه او التزامات اكثر او هكذا. يعني
So the question is the promissory note a promise to pay or is it an obligation which must be fulfilled? And the answer to that is that if the promise is made prior to the official closing of the transaction by both parties signing on the final contract or final set of contracts actually, then there is no obligation and there are no negative consequences, because legally speaking there is a differentiation between promising to do something and being obligated to fulfill something. However, if the customer or if the client goes to the actual closing table and then they are unable to fulfill their obligation, which becomes obligation at that point, then there is a whole different set of rules which apply, and laws actually, which apply to that transaction.
Okay, I might ask you now, both of you, brother Abdulrahman and Dr. Abdulbari, to answer just for 5 seconds for each question. Otherwise, I don't know if you agree to go through the comments after the, inshallah, halakha, after our session, to go through it, inshallah, if you want to answer the questions that we didn't answer it now. Now, the question from brother Fahd here, if you see it.
What is the source of Islamic Bank's funds, and how do you calculate profit rate on daily basis? Is it based on gold, or what source behind the calculation? So in 5 seconds, we already answered that question at the beginning of the presentation. However, the source of Islamic banks are two different sources, what we call the upfront source, and most of those financiers, they have their own equity or investors lined up based on Sharia structure. And then the ending result is that they sell or endorse those transactions back to Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae, who are enterprises and not banks, to support the liquidity and make the business scalable.
JazakAllah khair. Dr. Abdulbari, this is your question, inshallah, for you from Brother Hani Rosha. Assalamu alaikum.
في حال المشاركة والمرابحة ما هو الفرق بين البنك الإسلامي والبنك العادي في حال تعثر المقترض وفي حال البنك الإسلامي في أمريكا ألا تقوم البنوك بعد الإغلاق ببيع العقد؟ نحن أجبنا تقريبا على هذا فيما يتعلق بالمشاركة والمرابحة. يعني المرابحة ملكنا وبعنا، وفي المشاركة ملكنا الأصل بالمشاركة ونبيع بالتدريج حصتنا خلال فترة التمويل. البنك التقليدي لا يملك في الحالتين، البنك التقليدي لا يملك في الحالتين. في حال التعثر هنا، هو طبعا هنا يريد أن يلزمنا بشيء في ذهني هذا السائل. في حال التعثر إذا كان الدين ثابت في الذمة لا فرق بين التقليدي والإسلامي. الإجارة عقد ملزم، نستطيع أن نلزمه، ولكن لنا الخيار الذي نراه مناسبا، نستطيع أن نلزمه أن يستمر حتى النهاية. وفي المرابحة نستطيع أن نلزمه أيضا في الدفع، وفي القرض التقليدي هو ملزم أيضا في الدفع. ولذلك نحن قلنا فيما يتعلق بهذه الديون التي ثبتت في الذمة بغض النظر عن سبب نشوءها تقليدي أو إسلامي هي ملزمة، يهمنا نحن أن تكون ديوننا نشأت بالمرابحة أو المشاركة أو الإجارة، فهي شرعية وهو ملزم بأن يسددها في مواعيدها طبقا للبروموسري نوت اللي هو وقعه، طبقا للعقد الذي أنشأها. الشق الثاني ما ظهر عندي، نسيته أيضا.
Should we continue other question or go back to the
same question? تحدثنا عنها، بيع العقد لفريدي ماك تحدثنا عنها.
Okay, JazakAllah. Thank you, Dr. Abdulbari. Now, Sister Shafia, or is it possible to refinance a home that was purchased through conventional
interest? Yes, the answer is yes. You can.
Okay, thank you. Now, do you finance building of masajids and Islamic centers?
Yes, we do. And actually, we pride ourselves to be able to do two main things that differentiates UIF from other competitors. One of which is that we participate with masajids to finance them in a Sharia compliant way. And we've been even involved with a few selected masjids in the new construction phases as well. So the answer to that is yes, we do have a special program to finance masjids.
Masjid and Islamic school.
And Islamic schools.
Okay. Okay, other question from Sister Zainab Abdul, Abu Bakr.
Is foreign exchange currency trading acceptable in Islam? هل التجارة بتغيير العملة أو بالعملة مسموح في الإسلام؟ Relying on market fluctuations and currency to buy and trade to make profit. تعتمد هذه التجارة على الفروق السوقية بشكل يومي للحصول على مربح.
طيب شكرا استاذ عبد الرحمن. الحقيقه الجواب التقني الفني لا يجوز، من لان بناء على العلم بواقع هذه التجاره في العملات. يعني قد انا اجيب جواب فقهي واقول يجوز ان تبيع وتشتري عملات وتربح منها، لكن ما اعرفه انه في سوق العملات انت لابد انك تستخدم الاوبشن او سوابس أو فورورد، فكل هذه محرمة وغير مطابقة لأحكام الشريعة الإسلامية. حتى شراء سبوت في عملية السبيكوليشن أنت بترجع تعيد البيع بنفس اللحظة أو بعد فترة قصيرة قبل قبض العملة. فلذلك جوابي الشرعي المرتبط بالواقع ليس حلالاً.
So this question has a technical side of it and has, I guess, a fiqh side of it. In the pure fiqh approach, trading in any commodity is okay and it's allowable or permissible.
However,
in any currencies is permissible and there it's halal, no problems with it. However, from a technical perspective and practical perspective, in order to trade in within those types of markets, you have to use methods such as puts and options or spot buying, and those are methods that are not permissible in accordance to the Sharia.
Jazakallah khair. I think I don't know if we should continue go through the questions or we can stop here, and you, Brother Abdulrahman and Dr. Abdulbari, go through it to type the answers later on. Up to you.
I mean, I leave it up to you, Dr. Rihabi.
Okay, if you promise to give me answer just for 5 seconds each, I will go through it. Okay, Sister Umarik, mashallah, here again. Could you please go through the Murabaha steps and clarify the steps and conditions that the Murabaha follow the avoid to avoid risk and keep themselves away from riba?
Do you want me to answer Dr. Abdulbari, or do you want to take this question? تفضل حضرتك. هي تسأل عن الخطوات تحديدا، خطوات معاملة المرابحة. يعني تحب أن يكون فيه الخطوات متسلسلة لتبين عدم المخاطرة بأن نحن نخاطر أنه هو يكون معاملة ربوية. يعني
قلنا نملك ونقبض ونبيع، وهذا الأمر الشركات الإسلامية معنية بوجود الهيئة الشرعية والترقيق الشرعي والإلزام الشرعي لحماية هذه الجوانب.
In a installment situation, the financier would purchase the property, own it, resells it back to the customer at a marked up price, which includes their profit as well. If this transaction is endorsed and approved by an independent Sharia board, and there is certain Sharia governing dictating the actual transactions, then it's permissible with no issues.
Okay, Jazakallah khair. Sister Amal Abid, how much you should be making to get 350, and how much would be the down payment?
Just to simply answer the question, 5% is perhaps the minimum down payment that you can get a transaction approved with, and that is actually with somewhat of a strong credit. And when we say strong credit, we're talking about 680 or higher. However, for those specific questions, please again visit our website www.myuif.com and either fill out a PQ online or seek to speak with a representative. And somebody will get back to you as soon as possible.
Okay, Jazakallah. Brother Jabir here, Jabir Jarrad, a couple of questions. Do you own the house first before you selling to us?
The answer is yes, if it's murabaha or ijar.
Yes. Second question, is there a late fee if I didn't pay on time?
There is a late fee if the monthly payment is not made on time. And there is something here that's very unique to UIF that we do. Where no other competitor takes the same approach. It is permissible with an from a Sharia perspective to collect those late fees because it creates an incentive for the customer to remain on schedule. However, it is strongly recommended by Sharia boards that for these revenues to be donated to charity, and UIF does exactly that. We donate all of our revenues from late fee payments to charity. As a matter of fact, just this year, 2020, we were pioneers along with Sterling Charity Organization, Amana Funds, and Shenandoah University, Islamic, Shenandoah University Center for Islamic Contemporary Islamic Studies. We were pioneers to offer the first scholarship for higher education seekers that are children of either imams or centers of influence in the US. And alhamdulillah, this was a great initiative to support our imams and to support their children's education.
Jazakallah.
Not to mention that the late fee is actually very minimum. It's only a flat fee of $50, and it resembles the actual cost of collecting that fee. So marketing companies did the calculation or the study, how much does it cost a company to collect a late fee? And the number came out to be $50, which is exactly what we charge in case that happens.
Okay, in terms of profits, and as you mentioned, you have to follow the regulations for the land. What I am seeing, you still more expensive than the conventional loans.
If you call UIF sister with a specific transaction, I can almost guarantee you it's not going to be more expensive, inshallah. Just give us a try.
Yeah, jazakallah khair. There is a four question here. Can you read it, brother? Can you see it?
إذا كان على السؤال رقم أربعة يخبرنا ماذا وجد من مشاكل، خلي يعيد الاتصال علينا يخبرنا، لأنه هو مجرد يقول أنه هناك يعني عدم التزام أو شيء.
Yeah, please contact the phone number, the email, inshallah, UIF, brother Abdurrahman, directly, inshallah, you will get the answer, inshallah, ta'ala.
إن شاء الله.
سيستر هير سيستر أريج جراد معرفة أنه يفترض يشرع أن يكون العقار ممتلك من قبلهم تملك. I think we mentioned that. Yeah. Okay. But couldn't get.
I discussed with UIF three times, but I could not get my questions answered clearly. I really didn't know about UIF benefits. If possible, please share with us clear calculation of a house financing. Again, I don't think that this is the right platform for specific calculations. What I can tell you is the math is based on an amortization schedule, which is basically a standard formula that is used by all financial institutions to calculate your monthly payment.
Now, great question, but I don't like to mention names of the يعني شركات التمويل هي إمام مالك سيد ما معيار التفاضل بين شركات التمويل الإسلامي في أمريكا in general جزاك الله خير إمام مالك may Allah bless you إن شاء الله just معيار التفاضل بين شركات التمويل الإسلامي
معيار التفاضل يعني نقول إحنا برقم واحد نأمل وندعو الله أن يكونوا جميعا على خير لأنهم هدفوا إلى توفير البديل الإسلامي للجالية هذا رقم واحد رقم اثنين شركات التمويل الإسلامية يجب أن تكون حريصة أن يكون لديها مرجعية شرعية مستشار شرعي أو independent شريعة كوميتي أو شريعة بور لا ينفع أن يكون صاحب الشركة أو مدير الشركة هو المرجع الشرعي لابد أن تكون مرجعية شرعية مستقلة هيئة شرعية مستقلة هذه نقطة مهمة لابد أن يكون أيضا مدقق شرعي مستقل هذه نقطة في غاية الأهمية يعني أنا بدي أسأل الشركة في نهاية العام هل يوجد على موقع الشركة Independent شريعة ريبورت هل يوجد تقرير تدقيق شرعي من مدقق مستقل راجع أعمال الشركة وأصدر رأي بأنها ملتزمة بأحكام الشريعة هذه نقطة في غاية الأهمية هذا الأمر لا يتم إلا من خلال أيضا مصداقية في داخل الشركة وهي أن إذا اتصل أحد نجيبه بشكل واعي وبشكل مفهوم، وأيضا نضيف إليه قضية التعامل الحسن وأخلاق الإسلام في التعامل، وأيضا في التنفيذ الفعلي يتم أيضا وفق المطلوب الشرعي. ولكن في النهاية إذا قال لنا نحن شرعيون، هذه ثلاث نقاط يا أستاذ عبد الرحمن، هذه النقطة الثالثة، إذا قال نحن شرعيون نحن لا نصدقه. الأصل فينا أن نصدقه، لكن في عالم البزنس لا نرضى أن يزكي أو يزكي الإنسان نفسه. في عالم الحياة العملية لا يستطيع، ولا تزكوا أنفسكم، ولا تزكوا أنفسكم. في الحياة الطبيعية لا يستطيع يقول الإنسان أنا ما شاء الله أنا يعني على خير، هذا فيه غرور. فما بالك في العمل التجاري، لابد، لأنك أنت متهم، لابد من شخص مستقل، مدقق شرعي مستقل. فلذلك معيار التفاضل، معيار التفاضل مرجعية شرعية ومدقق شرعي مستقل يبدي رأي، وتضع هذا الرأي في كل عام، في كل عام تضع هذا الرأي في نهاية السنة على موقعك، حتى يدخل تدخل الجالية، يدخل العملاء وينظروا أن هناك رأي من شخص مستقل يوضح المشروعية. فمعيار التفاضل أصبح واضحا، لابد أن تكون الجالية واعية، الجالية المسلمة هنا في أمريكا، الأئمة الكرام يجب أن يكونوا واعين. أنا يبدو أكثرت الكلام، أستاذ عبد الرحمن ربما بعد ذلك يلخصها، ولكن أنا أعتقد السائل من الأئمة والجمهور العريض هنا بالعربية، يجب أن يكون الأئمة واعين. لا نزكي أي شركة إسلامية تزكية مطلقة، على أي أساس نزكيها؟ على أن يكون لها مرجعية شرعية مستقلة، وأن يكون لديها مدقق شرعي مستقل، وليس على ما تمتلكه من مستندات، وليس على ما تمتلكه من عرض إعلامي وتسويق لخدماتها. لابد أن نرى، لابد أن نرى، أؤكد أيها الأئمة الأكارم الذين تتابعون هنا في أمريكا، لابد أن نكون واعين، لابد أن يكون للشركة تقرير تدقيق شرعي من جهة مستقلة على موقعها محدث لكل سنة بسنتها. بارك الله فيكم. مسألة بسيطة، هل الشركة لديها تقرير من مدقق شرعي مستقل على موقعها يقرر أنها التزمت بأحكام الشريعة الإسلامية؟ هنا هذا معيار التفاضل. أما قضية نحن الأفضل، نحن الملتزمون، نحن الشرعيون وغيرنا ليس شرعيا، هذا لا يصح، لا في عالم الأخلاق ولا في عالم البزنس ولا في عالم المهنية إطلاقا. المعايير موضوعية مشاهدة مفهومة، نحتاج إلى أن يكون الأئمة على وعي، وليس والله نحن الأفضل وبالتالي يأخذ الإمام أن هؤلاء الأفضل، أو يأتي شيخ يقول أنا أنصحك بأن تذهب للتعامل مع هذه الشركة. لا، الآن نريد أن نتخطى الذي يقول أنصحك بالتعامل مع هذه الشركة أو هذه الشركة، وننتقل إلى الوعي الذاتي، الوعي الذاتي لدى الأئمة، وهو أن تنظر هذا التقرير على موقعهم، وأن تنظر مرجعيتهم أيضا. بارك الله فيكم.
جزاك الله خير. In 3 seconds,
brother. I was gonna complain about it. يعني 5 seconds is too short. خير إن شاء الله. So to start with, it's a very good point that we should not actually forget that Dr. Abdulbari mentioned that most companies, if not all of them, are على خير, which means they are good. Okay. ولكن بتفاوت. But you know there are differentiations, I guess, and the level of good between one company to another. In a nutshell, the differentiating factor between which company is better than the other company, there are 3 standards which should be followed. The first one is if they have a some type of Sharia reference. And what's the explanation of a Sharia reference here is either an independent Sharia board or somebody that's independent who give them fatwa, who reviewed the contracts and the process and everything else and give the fatwa on the permissibility of the product being offered by that company. The second reference is having an independent Sharia governing body or person or entity that reviews their process and makes sure that they are the customer's advocate and the Sharia advocate at the same time, so that the company is actually committing and fulfilling its obligation towards the process of being Sharia compliant. And the third, which is last, is someone, or an independent, again, auditor or auditing firm or audit that should be conducted at least once a year. And it should be posted on the website of the financier or of the company. With these three things in place, that at least starts the differentiation process in our minds. You know, then comes the ethics and the business pricing and all the other things, you know, follow those three main components. However, we should shy away from advertising for ourselves, saying that we are the best, we are the one and the only one, everybody else is haram, don't go there or the way or any other competitor. And the reason is we have a reference of the ayah, وَلَا تُزَكُّ أَنفُسَكُمْ. So even in regular life events, you're not supposed to be talking proudly about yourself and you know, presenting yourself as you are the only pious person or the good person and so on and so forth. And therefore, it's quite unethical for companies to start advertising about themselves in such manner that we are the only good ones or we are the halal ones, everybody else is haram and so on and so forth. But there is a much bigger point here, which Dr. Abdulbari is making for the imams of our community, for the imams, the leaders of the community, who everybody relies on for a piece of advice and relies on to actually make certain decisions relating to their lives or their financial needs, especially. That imams, especially, should shy away from getting, from being succumbed to marketing and publicity propagandas that are offered by the different companies, so that they promote one company over another because they are being impacted or affected by this type of propaganda. Because companies, they spend, they have different budgets and some have deeper pockets than others, and therefore the stronger and more widely publicity they can offer will actually impact the general public, but it should not impact our imams. Our imams should look at the three main components, which were mentioned by Dr. Abdulbari, having an independent Sharia board or Sharia reference, and not somebody who owns the business talking about their business being halal. Secondly, having some type of Sharia governing entity or body. And third, a regular annual audit, which should be posted in a report on the financier's website. It is very unethical for our imams, especially, to lead the community to recommend one company or another because of the publicity being offered by that company. They should shy away from that and stick to the principles. And these are the advices which should be given to our community members.
Thank you so much, Brother Abdulrahman.
Five seconds exactly. Yeah.
JazakAllah. It is khutbah Jum'ah, mashallah. But really, we need that information. And our brothers and sisters, they might come back to this video from the which is posted in the on Facebook, and they can review it, inshallah, again. We have last two questions, and I will stop after that. Then I will ask Brother Abdulrahman, Dr. Abdulbari, to go through the rest of the questions, inshallah, to answer it, inshallah, please. So this question now from Brother Muhammad. Islamic financing banks take loans from the governments using interest and turn around. Okay, can you please, Brother Abdulrahman or Dr.
Yes, this is very quickly the same question that gets repeated again and again. Islamic financing banks take loans from the government using interest and turn around and sell them to the Muslim population using a Sharia compliant contract. Is this true? If not, where do Islamic financing banks get their funds from? I think we've just explained that in previous questions. This is not true. Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae are not banks. We should not confuse them with banks. They are entities established by the government to act as investors in this arena, and they provide liquidity in the market, which Islamic banks alike with non-Islamic banks can benefit from that based on the Sharia compliance structure that's being agreed upon with those entities versus the non-Sharia agreement that is being struck with conventional banks with those same entities.
Okay, other questions,
JazakAllah. Actually, as a matter of fact, I'm sorry, let me add, if you actually go to their website, Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae's website, you'll find out surprisingly that under their definition that they are not permitted to lend money to banks. So this is actually one of their bylaws. They're not in the business of lending money.
Alhamdulillah, we are so blessed today to have, mashallah, a couple of imams with us. Alhamdulillah, may Allah bless them all, inshallah ta'ala. Brother Imam Daniel Hernandez asked this question. I think, Brother Abdurrahman, if you can go through it or you can answer or ask.
Sure. Question came in today. My name is Jankwell. Here is my situation. My fiance and I have started a tax preparation. I think we actually covered this question earlier when the sister asked about her tax services offering, facilitating loans which come from different banks to advance the money, the cash returns to the customers for an interest rate. However, the tax facilitator does not benefit from those fees. And the answer was by Dr. Abdulbari, this service is not permitted because it helps somebody to go through a non-Sharia compliant transaction. And if they were in fact benefiting from the fees of facilitating the transaction, that those fees should be given up immediately.
JazakAllah khair wa asal wa ta'ala an yubarika feekum. Sister Umm Malik, again, Astadhi al-Fadil, ijabatuk ala su'al mwajjah hawla al-wa'ad bishira ghayr wadih, wa lam tushir ila ayat adilla shar'iyya tufid wa tuwaddih al-bay' bi al-murabaha.
بالنسبة للأخت مالك أم مالك أجبناها بشكل واضح. الوعد بالشراء هنا في أمريكا ليس لازما, يعني وضح الأستاذ عبد الرحمن هذا الأمر, ليس ملزما لها يعني.
Okay.
The answer to this question was very clear that a promise to purchase is not does not create an obligation to be fulfilled. In other words, there is a difference between the promise to purchase, which is prior to the official transaction closing that takes place at the closing table, and the transaction post that event. If it's prior to that event and they want to renege on the promise to purchase, it's actually better for all parties because we will avoid a lot of trouble for both the financier and the customer alike. But reneging on the agreement post the closing event takes different ruling, because it becomes, once you sign that agreement, it becomes an actual obligation to fulfill, whether that transaction is based on Sharia compliant transaction or whether it's actually based on loan transaction. Both permissible and not permissible transactions must be fulfilled once the obligation is accepted and signed upon.
JazakAllah khair. I think this is the last question, and we if I miss any question, please forgive me, and just contact inshallah Brother Abdurrahman and Dr. Abdulbari. Sister or Moya Diaby, what
is the minimum down payment?
Payment in the general, yeah.
It's 3-5%. In most cases, it's 5% with good credit, good income, and good ratios. And when I say ratios here, I'm talking about income versus monthly expenses. Again, the best thing to do is to reach out to one of our field representatives in your state or to our website or 800 number and start a conversation with a professional. And I'm very sure that you will find two things: that you will be happy with our pricing and you will be even more happy with our service, as UIF was nominated and elected to be the best Islamic finance provider 6 years in a row.
Okay, can you find a finance building of Islamic Center and Islamic School in Kansas?
I believe we can, and I'm sure I get confused here because we offer residential is a little bit different than the commercial. This is under the division of the commercial division. Again, please reach out to one of our representatives and they will be able to direct you with the answer to that.
جزاكم الله خيرا الحمد لله رب العالمين. Thank you so much, brothers and sisters, and thank you so much, Dr. Abdulbari Mashal and Brother Abdulrahman Nashnoush, for your time and for this a lot of information, mashallah, around 2 hours, exactly 2 hours.
for hosting such session, and I think we truly do need to have more of these sessions just to educate our Muslim community with what is true and factual and what are the myths or misunderstandings. And I'm not talking about company level necessarily, okay, but I'm talking about a whole industry in general. And I'm really happy and excited to have worked with Dr. Abdulbari specifically over the past 3 years or over actually 4 years of my career, where I learned a whole lot that about this industry and about the details of what's really permissible and what's not. And we need more people such as Dr. Abdulbari with his knowledge and expertise to answer the questions based on true knowledge of the specialty, right? And I'm sorry that I'm closing here with more than 5 seconds, but it's almost like having a two physicians, one that is general practitioner who could be, with all due respect to all imams and all of our leaders who have the knowledge on so many different fields and so many different fiqh types, fiqh al-buyu'a, fiqh al-aqar, you know, the different fiqhs that are being offered, and a person that has that general knowledge, but actually specializes in an area that we have a huge lack and shortage in people who specialize in that. Why? Because those special people with the special knowledge have the knowledge of Sharia on one side and knowledge of the nature of the financial transactions, especially here in the US, which most people do not even have. So thank you very much for having a session like this. Thank you, Dr. Abdulbari, for all the great work that you do for the sake of this industry, more than one company or another. And inshallah, I hope that we can have more and more of these very useful and informative sessions in the future, inshallah.
Yes, very useful and informative. MashaAllah, may Allah bless you, Brother Abdulrahman. We need that. Our communities, our imams, our students of knowledge, they need to learn more, to know some details we don't know. We hear. And we talk what people are talking about. So it is good to know from the people. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. And here, Brother Abdulrahman and Dr. Abdulbari, they give us, mashallah, good and a lot of information. May Allah bless you, inshallah ta'ala, both of you, increase you in knowledge and in hikmah. May Allah bless our brothers and sisters, give them, inshallah, provide them good and halal and barakah in their life, in their income, in their families. Last word, Brother Imam, Dr. Abdulbari.
Jazakumullahu khairan, Dr. Rihabi, wa Sayyid Abdulrahman. Nahnu huna, yani, na'mal li توضيح الواجب ونقوم بالواجب تجاه الجالية. وأنا لاحظت أن الجالية تفتقد إلى معرفة بعض أفراد الجالية أو بعض مناطق الجالية تفتقد إلى معرفة أن هناك شركات تقدم التمويل الإسلامي. أنا أتلقى أسئلة كثيرة يسألني هل يوجد شركة تقدم تمويل إسلامي؟ هل يوجد بنك إسلامي؟ يعني المسألة هذه واجب الوقت في نظري بالنسبة لكل المنصات الإعلامية الإسلامية والجهود التي تبذلها دكتور رحابي تصب في هذا الموضوع. فنحن نبذل ما يجب علينا تجاه إيصال هذه الرسالة، رسالة التمويل الإسلامي إلى الجالية، لأنه نحن أمام أيضا تحدي آخر. يوجد عدد من أفراد الجالية يذهب إلى التمويل التقليدي تحت غياب المعلومة أو تحت الجهل بالمعلومة، من حيث أنه المعلومة مغلوطة تصله، أو تحت معلومة معادية أيضا أو ضد التمويل الإسلامي تصله من أطراف أخرى، أو تحت أيضا تشويه غير موفق تجاه الشركات الإسلامية اللي موجودة في أمريكا. فنحن نؤدي رسالة التوعية بالتمويل الإسلامي مع التوعية بما يجب على شركات التمويل الإسلامي إن شاء الله أن تفعل. بارك الله فيكم.
You are ناصح and الناصح مؤتمن. فمي الله عز وجل bless you إن شاء الله تعالى, increase you, bless all of our brothers and sisters those are working hard for these companies, and may Allah bless our communities as well, inshallah ta'ala. Brothers and sisters, jazakum Allah khairan. May Allah bless you, inshallah ta'ala. If you have any question, any comment, please put it in these, inshallah, comments. And brother Abdul Rahman, Dr. Abdulbari will inshallah come back to these questions if we didn't cover it now. Jazakum Allah khairan again. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.